Houston, swing and a miss, struck him out. The Philadelphia Phillies are 2008 World Champions of Baseball.
Good evening, sports fans, and welcome to another edition of Just Say Sports. I'm your host, John Maicher, along with my co-host and partner in crime, Jack Miller. How are you tonight?
I'm doing all right.
Tonight's question of the night. What would your ideal Phillies trade be? Whether it be Hamels, Papelbon, or somebody else on the roster. What team would you trade with, and who would you want back? Call us at 610-378-0426. Post on our Facebook page on Just Say Sports, or give us a tweet at Just Say Sports. All right, well, let's kick off tonight's show with the MLB All-Star Wrap-Up. Mike Trout, second consecutive All-Star MVP. Jacob DeGrom gave a solid case for an MVP candidate. Fantastic home run derby. Oh, my goodness, was that great drama.
And not only that, don't forget Aroldis Chapman as well. He came in and he struck out the side as well.
Yeah, he was firing bullets of 100 mile an hour plus. Great. That's great entertainment.
And not only that, Todd Frazier, the hometown kid,
won the home run derby.
Won the home run derby.
In dramatic fashion.
I know there were some people who looked at it and said, hey, he was the favorite because, but the fact is that
he was runner up last year.
And it was because of the fact is it was a time thing.
Yeah. Now, I like that time thing. That was very ingenious. Very well conceived and handled properly.
And like you talked about Mike Trout, there was a lot of guys that could have been
DeGrom, Chapman.
But I think they had to give it to a team of the winning side.
It's not so much that; it's best performance. Because he let off the game with a home run, and he laid out a double, which should have been a double. So, you know, it's guts in an All-Star game, in my book.
And wait a minute, and just think about it. Not only was, you know, last year he won the All-Star game MVP, but he also was the MVP of the regular season.
Yes, he was, which is a rare feat in and of itself. Like the whole multiple MVP awards in one season. Your thoughts, more of your thoughts, because I kind of gave my two cents already about the whole All-Star experience.
I don't know. For me, the game is fun to watch. Per se.
Well, what do you think about the home run derby?
I loved the home run derby. It was fun to watch.
But much better than what it was doing. It was like taking forever.
But like I said, part of me, you know, likes the old way where it's just like, you know.
It goes on and on and on.
You know, where we didn't have to say, let's have meeting now. Let's make this. Because there's a lot of people on there.
Oh, you're talking about the All-Star game.
Game itself where you have a lot of guys who are basically on these teams. That they know that they have nothing to play for, unless we see them getting traded somewhere down the road.
Which we know we'll tie into that at the end of the Phillies ramp.
But part of me just looks at it as like I just don't really like the scenario where we have now we have to make it into something special because I always liked it being alternate instead of the All-Star game.
That whole thing about multiple All-Star games in the NL and the AL is a recent development. Nobody knows why it's happening that way, but it's just happening. So.
But if you want to do anything, do it with best record. You know,
that's before it was. It makes sense.
I would do it with the team who has the better record. We get the. Now you got American League versus National League. Even though maybe the two teams maybe you're playing in the World Series don't play against each other.
The thing is, if you take the meaning away from the All-Star game, no one's going to want to go, and no one's going to want to watch.
Well, I heard it wasn't real. The ratings weren't for the All-Star game wasn't too as strong this year. It was down from last year.
Yeah, but we can always trace it back to remember that year was a tie in Milwaukee, 13-13, and they called it. See, they need to recover from that. They still haven't recovered all the way from that.
Well, you don't tie an
All-Star game, not in this day and age.
They could have added it. I don't mind the expanded rosters if they had it expanded. But one thing that made me think, I don't remember who said this, but they talked about instead of making it, like in that kind of meeting, have it as a situation where you have North America versus the world.
That's what the World Baseball Classic's for.
Yeah, but the World Baseball Classic is basically you have, you know, like
Dominican Republic. It's like a World Cup. It's like the World Cup of baseball.
Right, but I'm talking about an All-Star game where you just basically just have everybody in the major leagues are on one, I mean, in one team, you know, like for the world versus the North America, you know, Canada, USA, and Mexico, all in one.
I see where you're going. Hockey tried that, and it only lasted like 5 years. Then they went back to the East-West. Now they do a draft format, which is even better.
But like I said, it's just worth a shot, you know, to give something like that a shot.
No, I can see your reasoning for that. I'm old school, and I'm used to NL versus AL. It's how it's been for years. It's how I like it. So,
but sometimes, that's just me. But I look at it as like sometimes you got to spice things up and do something different.
No, you're
and especially when you take a look at
it's just know. If they're going to do it that way, there still has to be maybe whoever wins that gets home field in the World Baseball. Something has to be tied into that to make it matter more than just for your country.
Yeah, that could be something.
The All-Star
like
game, I agree, could use a shot like that in the arm, but for what? What are they playing for? What's the end game? You know what I mean?
But a lot of those guys, on those teams really have nothing to play for. Or some of those players, let's say, like on the American League side, you could end up seeing later down the line. Not saying it's going to be Mike Trout. I mean, you know, we know Trout's going to. But we're seeing some guys who played in this All-Star game, you know, maybe on losing, you know, maybe played on a losing team. All of a sudden, here they get traded.
Jeff Samardzija's situation a couple years ago in Anaheim. He was a Cub, then he went to the A's right before the All-Star game.
And that's what I'm saying, right? You know, right after, you know, right on the trade deadline. You see some of these guys who were in the All-Star game get traded to the other league.
Yeah, but that shouldn't matter, though.
Well, I mean, they're going like, hey, I played, you know, my heart out to win a.
Oh, for record. I got where you're going at with that now.
So it's just, that's what I just think it's just kind of, you know.
I told you, I'm old school with that stuff. Anyway, let's get to another baseball topic that I know we're just chomping at the bit to talk about. We're going to go a little bit more in depth. I know last week we touched on it. We kind of ran out of time. Phillies report card. Midseason report.
I give it a D because this team is, and not only that,
All right, now what we're going to do is, I know we gave our grades, total grades, we're going to break it down now.
I just think the whole team was so bad anyway. As I even said before the show started, I mean, you know, when it started, mm-hmm. you know, when we talked about it like a couple of months ago.
Yeah.
I knew that this was going to happen. It was going to be really bad. Granted, it got out of the gate a little early, but I knew how bad this team was going to be from the get-go. I was like, I even said, even Stevie Wonder could see something like that happening. That's how bad it is.
There's your joke for the night, folks. All right. Well, offense, grade.
Offense?
Yes. As a whole.
Actually, they're like 15th in offense.
Talk about giving your. I want your grade for their
My
offense.
My grade? Yeah. I'd probably give it a C-.
All
because
right.
of the that's fact is they're actually 15th.
And the fact that they're not going in. They knock on wood. This is the first time I remember this in a couple seasons. They haven't gone extended periods of time with not hitting. And the past two seasons, multiple. Like, we're talking about 20-plus games of, like, nothing. No hit, like, slumps. Look at the Mets. The Mets just went 25 at-bats in their 18-inning win against the Cardinals, which ties their franchise record and the third most in history. The Phillies, luckily, have not done that yet. Because that's the most aggravating part of these poor Philly teams these past few years. They just don't hit. Hasn't been the pitching so much. It's just they haven't hit. As for that, pitching, what did you give a grade for the starting pitching?
The starting pitching, that's been up and down, a little inconsistent.
But what's your grade?
But I'll give it a C.
Uh-huh.
Because the starting pitching hasn't been as terrible.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, I just think, you know, we'll get the grade for the rest of, like, the bullpen and stuff like that. But,
well, why not? If you get what, give him.
But
give
if
your
I give the bullpen, I give like, I'll be kind and say a D-.
I'm actually going to give it an A-, and there's reasons for that. But continue.
Because they've had periods where it was just awful. Like example with Cole Hamels.
That's starting pitching. You're talking about bullpen there.
But I just think it's just overall we still got a lot of work to do on our bullpen, and we know Cole Hamels probably won't be around.
Nor will Papelbon, most likely, or a couple others. All right, the way I see it, offense, I'm going to give it a C-, I agree. They've gone through stretches where they just can't hit, but then when they hit, they hit. I mean, it's not like they hit and then go cold right away. They go with streaks. They had about as many streaks of non-hit games, of like not hitting, as they have with hitting. You know, it's kind of like they flip the switch on, they flip the switch on, off, about as evenly as you possibly could with a team this bad. So I'm going to give them a C-. Starting pitching, I'm going to give that a D because it's been atrocious.
I think injuries I think play a part of it too.
Hamill's not so much. He's got so much on his mind right now with the whole trade deadline. Billingsley, he's had his bright spots. Aaron Harang was a very big bright spot until he got injured. Sean O'Sullivan, I don't even know why they're using him as a starting pitching. Put him back at the bullpen. Get somebody else up. Aaron Nola, which he will start on Tuesday, and we'll get to that in just a minute. Billingsley, he's on the verge of, I think, getting himself hurt. I don't know why I got that feeling, but other than that, he's been a relatively good bright spot. Buchanan, hard luck kid. He's the Kendrick of this year's Phillies. Just can't seem to get a break. It's about like hit or miss with each starter. Bullpen, I'm going to actually give it an A- because despite all the controversy over Papelbon and whatever he decides to say, I love colorful characters in Philly. It just gets me all going. Papelbon has made every save attempt he's been given this year. He's not K-Rod territory, which is like 21 for 21, but he's 15 for 15 or 16 for 16. And that's saying something for a team that's this terrible. Giles, when he's good, he's good. Same with DeFreitas, same with Garcia, same with some of the others. It's just when they have their spots when they're terrible, they're horrible, horrendously horrible. Like, why not give them a day off kind of horrible? Like as if they used up what they had in the tank the game before. And it's just,
but like I said, when I made my grade, it wasn't basically, you know, not including Papelbon.
I figure that.
But it was based on the others.
I have two bright spots for this year's team. What are your two bright spots?
Mikel Franco.
All right.
Is one of them, and I'm trying to remember. And I can't think of another one right off.
I can think of a couple.
I would probably like, what was it you said, Harang?
Aaron Harang, yeah. I'm going to say the young kids that have all come up, Hernandez, Franco, Nola, who's getting ready to come up. Now, it's a little premature to say that, but I got a feeling about him. He's got a good minor league in the Reading system and Lehigh Valley. Excuse me. I don't know, just the young kids have kind of stepped up. Even Cameron Rupp at times, Darren Ruff at times, like Ashy at times. You know, like there's been enough turnover that once some of these other veterans go, I think they'll be good for a little bit. They're not the greatest players, but they'd be good for the core.
And in my mind, Franco probably should, nothing against Papelbon, but I probably would have said Franco would have been better for the All-Star game.
No, I agree. But heck, Papelbon didn't even get a chance to pitch. And I'm going to say the veterans that have stepped up, Franco, Papelbon, despite the controversy around him, Harang, you know, some of the veterans you don't expect, like even Howard's having a better season, much to everybody's surprise. But biggest disappointment for me is Utley. I think his season's going to be, if not, once it's done, I bet you he retires. What about your biggest down spot?
I got to go with my biggest down would probably be Utley as well. Mainly because of the fact is that, one, I don't even think Utley should have been there anyway. I think, you know, I still would have rather not
have
signed
him off. Yeah,
I would have shipped him off or not even re-signed him or whatever. And say, we love you. We know we love you. I mean, we know what you meant to Philly. But sometimes business is business,
and we need to turn the page. Basically.
Right, that's how I felt. Even though we disagree,
earlier in the year, yeah.
But I've always been a person that said business is business. You know, you have to let the young kids take over. You know,
yeah.
Like they did with letting Rollins go.
For me, my overall grade's a C. I know I said it was incomplete, but I've seen enough now that it's better than I was expecting, but it's not like something that it's not like a season that none of us as Philly fans were expecting. You know, we knew they were going to be bad. A little bit better than I thought they were going to be. I thought they were absolutely atrocious. But
I don't think they would be as bad, but they really stunk.
Yeah.
I thought they would be like...
Their moments of greatness have been great. Their moments of horrendous and atrocities has been utter garbage. So...
Well, we know the one thing we agree is Ruben Amaro should be gone, fired.
He'll be gone by the end of the year. He's not going to go during the season because of what he has done. You know.
Yeah, but we all... But like I said, we both
he'll
agree.
Be gone
he'll be gone.
He'll be gone.
If not, you know, that's why we're pulling for ourselves to be taken over as the GM of the Phillies.
How about we switch topics now that we're thinking about it? Golf. We were talking about this before the show. Finally, the British Open got completed today, and you want to fill everybody in?
There was a playoff with three players in it. It was Zach Johnson, Mark Lehman, and Oosterhuis.
Yeah,
Zach Johnson ended up winning on the last hole. You know, there was a shot at, you know, a shot for Oosterhuis, mm-hmm. you know, to get into that, let's say, that next playoff.
Yeah, next playoff, yeah.
But he ended up missing a shot that was, like, really close. It was just, like, in and out.
Yeah.
That ended up, you know, just putting his thing, I mean, putting his game in problem. I mean,
in jeopardy.
And we almost had Jordan Spieth, but if he didn't double bogey in the bogeyed in on 17, mm-hmm. we would have probably had four guys in the playoffs.
Ah,
and not only that, we also had a young kid named Paul Dunn.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he was ranked 20th in the he's ranked 20th as an amateur.
Yeah,
and I can't remember where he finished, but I think he still finished in the top 10, but. He ended up after three rounds leading this thing.
And granted, you got to remember a couple of days ago they were having the wind issue and
they had the wind issue, they had a rain issue.
Yeah.
So that got pushed everything back.
And that's why they wrapped it up today. So no, it sounds like I didn't get a chance to watch the end, but it sounds like it was one heck of a finale for Open that really needed it because of the fiasco with the wind and the rain on Saturday.
And not only that, there were four amateurs that finished in the top 20. And they said the last time four amateurs finished in the top 20 was back in 1960.
You know the names or no?
I don't remember. I think they said one of the names I remember hearing was Tom Watson.
Ah, and it's fitting that this was his last major. It's fitting how that ties in. So I know you wanted to talk about Wimbledon.
Yeah, Wimbledon. Serena Williams is still, you know, up. You know, has a chance.
She has won, I think, the most Grand Slams in recent. I can't remember.
She's one behind Steffi Graf.
Yeah, that's. I know she's closing in on the all-time lead in Grand Slams.
And if she wins the U.S. Open, This will be the last time a player won. All four majors in the same calendar year was 1988 with Steffi Graf.
Dang, that's a milestone in and of itself because it is hard. It's just like golf. It's hard to win all four major titles in one year.
And I think part of and in my mind, I still think she's the best all time. I mean, Serena, in my mind, because I don't know what about Margaret Court because Margaret Court still holds the most wins, majors for a woman with 24.
Yeah, it was like back in the 60s and the 70s?
I think the
50s.
It was the 30s. 20s and 30s.
Got it.
Margaret Court. But I don't know the talent. But when Steffi Graf played, I know she could destroy me on the tennis court. I know that. But
I think she could destroy anybody on the tennis court.
I think she could destroy both of us if we both played her, you know, 2-on-1.
That's true.
But,
that's true.
But I just feel like at the time she played...
I'm not even good at ping pong. Continue.
I think at the time she played, I think it was probably the weakest time for women's tennis. I mean, I'm not saying...
Margaret Court or Serena Williams?
No, I'm talking about Steffi Graf.
Ah.
When Steffi Graf played, I couldn't... You know, when I mean, granted, they said, she did play Navratilova, but...
That was the rival back then.
Navratilova and Steffi Graf. Navratilova and Chris Evert were like basically going on the downside of their career. Because, you know, that's mm-hmm. how I looked at it, was that we know they were on the down. I mean, they were still competitive per se.
Yeah.
But you know, because of their age, they were on the downside of their careers. But I just couldn't see anybody that, in my mind, that Steffi, you know, that we could say, well, you know, this was, you know, you had all these challenges. Compared to Serena, you know, she played against her own sister. You got, you know, some of the other players, you know, a lot of a better competition than what Steffi Graf played. That's how I look at it.
I think each era has its own competitive charm, if you will.
Yeah.
So, like, especially if you look at the men's side, you got Sampras versus Agassi for all those years, and now you got Djokovic, Federer, and Nadal. Oh, and Andy Murray. So you got four at one shot. So, and each one keeps over superseding the other. So.
And we know, and I don't know.
It's all about dominance. That's what it comes down to in tennis. About how dominant can you be in your time of playing the game.
Think, like I said, with Djokovic, he is getting better, because I remember watching him a couple of years ago, how much he really struggled. But you could see the improvement in his game. You know, from if you would have saw what he looked at a couple of years ago.
Yeah.
He doesn't. You know, he. It's just a total makeover. You know, from what he was, because. He would have lost, because since he lost the second set, mm-hmm. the old Djokovic would have just basically just left. I mean, just went out.
Mm-hmm. So, all right, we got 3 minutes left. Let's do some shout-outs real quick. Mine is Ty Henson of Lehigh. He had the game-winning hit in the AAA All-Star game on, what was that, last Wednesday.
And mine's Paul Dunn. You know, who says most people know he's ranked 20th in the world. And yesterday, after three rounds, he was actually the leader. I mean, granted, he didn't win. The last time a player won as an amateur the British Open, you had to go back to, I forgot the guy's name off the top of my head, you had to go back to the 20s.
Francois Omet, maybe?
No, you had to go back all the way to the 20s.
Wasn't Ben Hogan?
He was one of the premier hockey players. Bobby Johnson.
Hockey players?
No. Bobby Jones, sorry. Bobby Jones.
I got you now.
I apologize. Right. It's just the name slipped my mind.
That happens. All right. My next shout-out is Jeff Francoeur with the walk-off yesterday. If he is not a Philly after this season, I will be upset, because that was a smart pickup when he came back. Who's your next shout-out, if you got one?
I got to give it to Pointer. You know, because he was an all-star game hero, you know, from the Reading Phillies.
Talk about the Reading Phillies.
Yeah, the Reading Phillies. He ended up, he was a ranked 20th, and he actually played in the all-star game. And
talk about the Futures game, right?
Yeah, played in the Futures game.
All right. My final shout-out will be Aaron Nola, because he pitches Tuesday night. Be interesting to see what he does. That's all I got for that. Who's your final shout-out?
I got to give it from last week, Garbine Masarega.
Okay.
I apologize.
That's fine. Who is the person and what?
And she, even though another 20th lady, ranked 20th, she lost to Serena Williams in the finals of Wimbledon. You know, this is her first ever major final.
And she got all the way up to the what? That's right. The finals to go into the
Garbine Masarega.
Got it. That's the Spaniard, right?
I think she's a Spaniard.
Yeah, right, that makes sense. That's a good shout out. That's a good shout out. All right, next week we start hitting the divisions for the NFL season coming up. That means Eagles fans, get ready to call in, because we got tons to talk about. Along with my co-host Jack Miller, I'm your host John Maicher. We'll see you guys next week. So long, folks.